It's Jacek Brodzki. I'll give a question of Southampton. His work on non-commutative geometry, his work search encompasses many disciplines of topology, such as theory, and now he's doing some exciting work on applied topology as well. But then he's going to tell us about the geometry of synchronization products.
Introduction, and thank you to the organizers for the kind invitation to speak here. And not only that, much more so for the creating this exciting event. This is the day of the Clarton, the lecture room is still full. So that means that something interesting is happening. Before I go on, I just want to mention that at Southampton we have created a group called DOPS, which collects people interested in various aspects of data analysis, scanning topology, but also switching out into machine learning statistics, and very many schools work with us, medics, mathematologists, and so on. If you're interested in working with us, you are invited to come visit us. So, the talk has to do with a slightly different set of ideas to what we have discussed most of the week. It has to do with understanding group actions. You know, topology is not just the systems, it's not just matter and reef graphs. We still got grips with understanding symmetry, group action. Many of the things which are classical in topology. It's set up to present, if you like, an extension of what we are talking about this week, monometric methods. I'm not sure that the critical projects that they can be developed there. But the basic problem is very simple. Imagine that you have a bunch of objects, and those objects have some non-trivial geometry. You want some simple-minded questions. Are those all similar in some sense? Okay, if I identify, will tell me everything I need to know about the set of objects that I have. How many representatives do I need to collect from this to know everything about the structure of objects in my set? So here's an example. They all be these little disks with spiky arrows. They all look similar, but are they then? You know this question, so what would you mean by identical? Okay, and when I was drawing this picture, I still remember what Vitaly said in his talk, that his chemist friends do not believe in noise. So you see, despite the fact that this was very sharp and very focused, I will tell you that we don't always know the structure of these objects precisely, because there will be noise, there will be metadata, and so on. But what will mean that the two objects are identical? That's one obvious possibility, given that this is a set of disks and we are in two dimensions, it seems, can I from one to another by rotation? Okay, so I have a partially successful answer. It seems I have two obvious rotations, and I cannot, it seems, to go from here by rotation, because I just make these kind of flipped ones. So the reflection is involved. You see, so if you thought that they were all identical, this arises that we have two classes. By edges, you can get from one object to another by rotation, but you need a reflection to get into that. There are some disks that got left out. It's a separate class. Because in creating this motive, I just split two of those spikes and left the other two alone. So you cannot get from here to rotation. You need some kind of permutation as well. See the problem. You have those geometric structures, and you want to preserve, and you want to understand, and you want to classify the information provided by the geometry. So simulation problems, roughly speaking, they work with a sequence of objects, with a class of objects, and a group or collection of groups. And a minimum, if you like, that's your goal. You want to do a set of transformations that will connect objects in your class the actions from a particular group. So you can find a sequence of elements that allow for a macro transformation like that. Then you say that your objects can be synchronized. So that realization is. Okay. So I gave various versions of this talk, various events. So apologies if you've seen this before, but these are all very interesting. So I think they it's good to repeat them. So some of the techniques that we've already discussed, there are other fantastic methods, like for instance, electron cryo microscopy, which is designed to a three-dimensional structure of molecules, X-ray. When we think about this is just such a phenomenal statement. You're saying that we now can X-ray things, and we can see shapes of molecules. I mean, this is in the future. this is fantastic. So you understand this. But what you have is a roundly selected two-dimensional projection of your object. These are the kind of images that you get. And the technique itself is nice. You're intricate. You arrange molecules in a layer, cool them down until they stop doing too much, take an X-ray, and then to understand the structure, you know that all the molecules in the layer are the same, because that's how you arrange them. You say, let's assume that this set of images are really X-rays of one molecule, okay, along randomly selected directions. Together, can I actually figure out the two-dimensional shape of the molecule I'm after? Maybe the answer is yes. The analysis involved in that is formidable, and his co-workers have an analysis paper to describe the analysis of the side of that. But for now, I'm going to concentrate on the geometric side of the problem. So you immediately see that before you begin to apply this method, you need to show that indeed our objects in this class are, if you like, four objects of just one or under in a group action. So numerous motivations come from shape analysis. And I'm sure you know that people have studied shapes for a long time. And very sophisticated, intricate algorithms and computational methods for understanding, classifying, and comparing shapes for various reasons. So there's one position, if you raise evolution of organs. This is part of the tree of life illustrated through teeth. If you want to understand if two animals belong to the same species or different species, you might, for instance, take a tooth from each in the position on the jaw, move it somehow, and try to eye the resulting shapes. Are they similar enough so that they belong, so you can say that animals belong to one species, or are they different so you have subspecies or maybe separate species? Here is the true example of my discs. This is very noisy for Turing, and the reason is part of the reason why we don't normally get a complete graph when we form a structure like that. We may simply not be able to fit a transformation between two objects to with accuracy, which is adequate for what you want to do. That would be possible. So get an incomplete graph like this. Do we have one photograph or do we have many? In this particular example, it's clear that we can get from every point to every other point through some convoluted path. So we have one photograph here. So the view is going to be like this. We will take as an input a set of objects and a set of group actions, and we want to partition these objects into orbits of the given group action, where each element will be connected by work. So that's a separate element. That's sort of essentially the real part is to make it a little more computable. If yes, I can connect object, but I have to carry out a 150-step procedure to get from here to there, whereas all the other objects in my class are connected by 3 or 4 steps. Just again, maybe that's something that's not quite right. Numerous applications for these methods, geometric morphometrics, is the chief example, graphical questions of graphical analysis, network and the cryo-EM has already been mentioned. Numerous groups, you see, numerous classical groups have already appeared as targets for the study here. So, quite a bit gives rise to these methods have been developed in manifold learning. Contributors are Singer, Wu, and their co workers. So groups like O1, U1, the orthogonal groups, cyclic shifts, the Euclidean group, permutation groups, the special orthogonal group, and so on, have appeared in various versions of this problem. And this talk is based on our joint work with Singer and Chan Mukherjee, and the paper is on the archive if you are interested. So the structure of the talk is going to be the following. I will take you through a very simple format of the problem, and I will show you that this is very easily understood in terms of holonomy and walks and graphs. I will describe the bundle structures. So, you know, you shouldn't forget that there exist fibre bundles, and we hate them so much. And I think just for examples of how this interaction might happen. Okay, and there will be a slight detour into cohomology. So, all you people who have sophisticated theories with high degree cohomology will have to scale down a bit. I'll show complex in degree 0 and 1. Okay, we demonstrate there is still enough structure there. An algorithm that learns group actions, and I'll show some examples. So let's talk about the basic setup. So you will know, if you have any data set, the initial instinct is to represent it as a graph where the vertices are whatever points you have in your set, and the edges are set up by some notion of similarity. This is how we all begin. But it's going to play a slightly different role. So imagine that the vertices contain objects that I'm interested in, and it will describe transformation to get me from one object to the next. Okay, so if such a transformation exists, it will create an edge. The problem is phrased as follows. I have a function from the set of vertices of this graph to some group, which is fixed for now, and map from the set of edges to the same group. seems that this graph, that this edge function has a property that if I traverse an edge in the opposite direction, I take the inverse element. Following Singer and co-workers, I call these vertex and edge potentials. Question, can I arrange this so that the vertex and edge potentials are compatible, so that if I put an edge from here to there, then the graph assigned to this element, to this vertex, is the same as the element multiplied by the next vertex element. This compatibility across an edge, and here the two potentials are compatible if and only if they compare across every edge in the graph. And I will show you one interesting definition to the case where the vertex value is not in the group but in some module of the group. Okay. So geometry truly begins. So, a synchronization question or synchronization problem is this: if I have an edge potential, so a map from edges to the group, does there a vertex potential which is compatible with it? The problem in the simplest setting is easy. So if you have a vertex potential, it's very easy to compute vertex potential which takes values of the group. It's very easy to the compatible edge potential quickly doing this. So multiply one vertex element by the inverse of another. This is a compatible edge potential. Of course, if you do not have group elements, vertices, if the edge potential takes values in a G module M, you can't do this and you have to think a little more. So let's just introduce some basic ground theoretic machinery. So path is a concatenation of consecutive edges in the graph. Once you define a graph, a passing graph, then of course you map from edges, the edge potential gives a map from paths in the graph to the group, where you simply walk the path and multiply the group elements that you find along this path. So that map from paths to the graph, which is a simple property, is a very nice reversal property. So if you walk in the opposite direction, so if you reverse the path in this sense, they get the inverse of the element assigned to the original path. Then we concatenate paths. So the concatenation of paths translates into group opposites. So many homotopic theorists and geologists, they know what's coming there. The other thing is to ask, so what happens if I wander from a vertex, walk up and come back to the same vertex? So I've created the base loop in this and because of the setup I just defined, it's very natural from the space of base loops, so loops which start and end at a vertex with one in the group. Or to make it complete, I added the trivial loop, which is where you don't go anywhere and assign to it the identity of the group. The group of the set of elements that are created by finding group elements to every base path is a subgroup of G, and call it the holonomy group of V. If the graph connected every two holonomy groups are isomorphic, pretty much for the same reason as are in the standard homotopy theory. This is the first very simple observation of a synchronization problem, which says that in terms of walks and loops and paths, it's very simple to following if you have a connected graph with an edge potential. The compatible vertex potential, if and only if the holonomy G which means all holonomy of every vertex is trivial. And there is, it's possible to create from this a notion of the holonomy of the whole graph, which collects the notion about the whole graph, but it's also true in this case. Okay? It's very simple, but it's worth saying. So if you have this graph and you define vertex potentials, which means that there is a group element associated with every edge in this graph. So it starts somewhere, and how do you assign a to this vertex W? Okay? So you draw a path, and the thing that you've assigned the identity here, you just give this vertex whatever group element you brought with you by multiplying edge elements along this path. Does it depend on the path? Well, only of the set of the trivial, if you take other paths, then by combining them, you've created a loop. If you go one path and come back along the inverse of the other path, you've created a loop. Whether the holonomy of every loop is trivial, so the group element is defined, doesn't depend on the path you take. There's one or two steps to deal with the counter statement, but they're not very difficult. But this is a good illustration that you see you have a problem which computationally is very, very difficult, but conceptually is quite simple. And there are already structures that help understand really what's going on with this. So that's a little more complicated, but before I move on, there is a simple corollary, of course. A triangle is an example of a loop. And if you have synchronizable potentials, there is a triangle, you have the property that you walk around this triangle, you get entity. And I mentioned this because these kind of cycle consistency conditions are actually quite popular in literature, in the shape analysis literature. So I'm just pointing this out. The conditions on the potential that we have defined, which if you go anywhere, you find the identity element of that. If you go and back, again, it's the identity, and walking along every triangle produces an identity. It produces the identity. So here's an example from a paper by Huang and Gibbard from 2013. As I said, it emerges from analysis and shape connection, analysis of shape collections and so on. Sorry? Yeah. These are the cycle conditions that which are consequences of the trigonomy that I gave you. But there are also topologies, so you've read the steam rod. So you know it by heart, right? you know also that those cycle conditions, they have to do with defined bundles of the series. And Zeno tells us, all the way from the ancient history of 1951, you have a logical group acting on some topological space, but another space, X or Y, is one space on which G acts. And you have another space which covers sort of a system of groups, and you have a system of coordinate transformations. So these coordinate transformations take value in the group G, and the coordinate transformations satisfy the cycle conditions I just gave you. But now, instead of parameterizing the coordinate transformations by elements in the graph, you parameterize them by overlaps of sets. In covering, then it's a fibre bundle with the base space X and fibre Y with the structure group G using the transformation like J. So in a sense, this is what I said, if you have a system of coordinate transformation satisfying the cycle condition, the cycle consistency condition, then you have a G bundle on the space X with fibre G and the group G acting on it. So just before I move on. So essentially what we have understood, the graph, the top, it's like nerve of the cover that creates this bundle. So we have forgotten the cover, we have forgotten the space, but what remains is the graph and the coordinate transformation. But then, instead of building this graph on the space, on the base space, we have built the graph on the of its binding cover. And you see the phylogeny. So this is now iteration, why it's important to allow more general spaces for vertex potentials than just the group. If there are modules of the G, then the phylogeny just described to you. That is a holonomy in terms of bundles now. If you start an element in the fibre and want a closed loop and come back to the same base point, you end up in the same place along the fibre. Well, it's a holonomy along this loop, it's trivial, but the discrepancy which is measured by a group element is precisely the holonomy along the path that you have traversed. Okay, so now begin to see that the setup, you have a set of objects with non-trivial geometry, and the role of these fibers is to improve the geometry that you want to understand. So immediately, you go from just to bubbles on graphs, remembering that our cycle conditions tell you that there is some topological space with fiber and so on. So to me, here is an example theorem. So here, a topological group and connected graph, and my group potential times the addition. Then let's create an open cover of this graph and use a bias an open star of a vertex. So this is an example of an open star of a vertex. Here's another vertex with an open star. And intersect the two stars is essentially of two stars is of neighboring vertices is of course a single edge, and there is a transition function which responds to this to this. So given this that, and this is the theorem that we proved with Tingram-Gao and Shine Mukherjee, this defines a bundle of this graph G with this system of local trivializations. So this is synchronizable and only if the bundle is flat. So yeah, it has to do with the curvature of the bundle, and synchronizability gets translated into some flatness condition. So this bundle, that's the synchronization bundle, and we have synchronization problems are in one-to-one correspondence with levels on the graph up to isomorphism. So now, okay, so the theorem describes what happens when you win. Okay, the synchronization problems. So if you lose, is there anything interesting to say? Because, you know, the first question will be, so how long is it that I will be able to solve this synchronization problem? Okay. So let's look at the compatibility condition. And so this is what it means for the vertex potentials to be compatible. So the measure of failure of synchronization problem would be by a difference like this. And of course, I can't really now assume that these are group elements. I need some structure which will make it sensible. But let's assume that we now set values for F. F set values in some G module within a product. And let's also assume that the group I'm interested in is a subgroup of the group of linear transformation of this. Then the effect of synchronization can be measured by something a aptly called for sync. This gets when you can't solve it. Clearly, it measures the amount by which you miss the synchronization solution. And quotient is a normalization factor so that you can compare meaningfully functions. If one of them is probably closer to a solution than the other. But those of you who study that from graph theory will recognize that these quotients typically are related to relative quotients, where you have a quotient of two, where this quadratic form determines an operator, which is typical of the Laplacian. So in this setting, your guess for what this grand action Laplacian might be is given by this formula. So a few minutes of the topics are going to be spent by analyzing what this might mean. In under the discrete Hodge theory, graph Hodge theory case, the situation is as follows. You have a graph that functions, you give yourself some co-cycles in degree zero, which are just functions on the vertices with values. Some field K, K is the complex numbers. But the distance finite fields are very much in fashion. So, yeah, you have to be not dismissive about K anymore. I'm not saying this because when you're an operator algebraist, like in the things that do, only complex numbers in the world are the one that feels really. So, important. For people like me, it's important to remember that. Exist, yeah, other fields as well. So the one forms of one co-chains are the schizometric functions on the edges. And this is a very simple co-chain complex, can be rightly regarded as an analogue of the Durham complex. A very simple differential, which is the gradient. You take a function and calculate the gradient so that you measure the differences of its values across the edge. And there is a natural differential with respect to very natural product on the spaces, and the divergence in the true calculus sense of divergence. So the equation of this going there and back is the standard Laplacian in degree zero. Laplacian in degree zero is the composition of these two operators. You go up by d, come back by delta, and this standard graph Laplacian. So in this case, pretty different, but not much so. The standard gradient, there is this twisted gradient, the twist is provided by the group action. And now, instead of taking our scalar values, they have values in the G module. But, there is a differential, this is a very, very natural way to do it, and the divergence is still the same as the Laplacian that we had is the composition of two differentials as before. Namely here, because there is a problem to find these things like that in the way I just indicated, so the twisted differential from degree 0 to degree 1 and the divergence to come back. Impose Q symmetry as we did before, this does not map Q symmetry functions and edges and the calculation. And the other indicates that what we're doing is actually very bundle in spirit. You see, what we're doing is no longer creating functions. On the ground. What I'm doing here is you are creating sections of bundles. And again, if you have some local sections over the neighborhoods of the bundle, you need to think about how to glue them to get global sections of the bundle you're interested in. And again, transition functions dictate what happens on the overlaps if you're defining neighborhoods or trivializing neighborhoods. That's again a key factor in how you glue local sections to get global sections.
So this is a key, you see what we need here. So this
with the local expression given in the neighborhood of a vertex pi. Okay, so this is what happens. So your vertex says, okay, from my point of view, it looks like this. But the neighboring vertex is saying, oh, no. Your gradient is minus your gradient, and rho is in the wrong place. You see? So that's what happens in bundles. And all of this, you use the agents that we have at our disposal. So you see, this kind of picture actually has to be upgraded. From the beginning, this very simple case, we are really talking about sections, forms of being sections of some bundle on the ground, and those are created from the transformations given the edge potential rho. So you go from the combinatorial Hodge theory, which is very rich scalar, to this bundle Hodge, twisted Hodge theory, which you see even when just 2 degrees, that there is something to think about and there is interesting structure. You have Laplacians, you have harmonic forms, which are the current, which are elements of the kernel of the Laplacian, and there is a Hodge theory, the Hodge decomposition, where it says that differential forms can be decomposed into harmonic forms and the rest, and the homology is given by the harmonic form. And once you have done this bundle magic, there is a Durand theory which says that the spaces cogent do decompose as kernel of the differential d rho and the image of the subjoint. The solution of the synchronization problems are elements of the kernel of the twisted differential and so on. So that gives us a very precise understanding of where synchronization fits into the general structure of Durand-type theories. Let's talk about some applications. So if a group acting on some set X, we want to learn perhaps a new, slightly different group action on G and the partition of the into disjoint subsets. So the following. The new if you have formed the new action, it has to stay reasonably close to what you originally had. And on partition, is cycle consistent. So if you're interested in representation theory, learning group action is the restatement of finding irreducible representations that form a particular representation of the group on a particular vector space. So this is a very simple set. We call them things, but it's just the fact that you have a function on the two-element target space. So it looks more serious. If your function takes values in the plus minus one, so it's like spin up and spin down. And that you have a group, which is a two element group, which flips them, acts charitably on the set, and the spins as necessary. The K even in the case, what you realize is the following, that even if you do not know the spin at point, so you know the group actions, the feature of which is essentially spectral clustering according to the twisted Laplacian, will realize that there are two orbits inside here. So of course, the feature will not know where those clusters are spin up or spin down, but it will know that there are two clusters. So using the spectral clustering, it's an extension of the spectral clustering procedure that uses the Laplacian, you will be able to reconstruct the original. So if a spin where
circles one direction and the crossing the other direction. The spectral clustering resolve five clusters, which is encouraging. But quite. However, here's something simple-minded. If your data consists of a bunch of objects like this, so these are molars, these are number of molars, and marks by people who know about such things with micro points. Okay? And if you count the procedure, this extension of spectrum using the twisted line. Yes, in this situation, the group actions are deduced from Prokrasky's type analysis, where you take sort of marker points. So each of those, there are theme points for each tooth. So you can replace the tooth by, if you like, 16 vectors in R3. And the question is, how do you match them as well as possible? So this is a Prokrasky's type analysis. If, having constructed an orthogonal transformation that takes one set of markers to another, you say, okay, is there any information in the determinant of the transformation I found? Then the answer is yes. And the teeth on the side of the jaw are different to the teeth on the right side of the jaw. I didn't think about this until I learned that of course it makes perfect sense. Yes. If identical, chewing would be difficult. It makes perfect sense. And little, one of many devices that nature has produced for us is encoded in -1. You can discover it. Here's a more complicated set. So you have a bunch of teeth from a different animals. So these are no longer lemurs. I forgot what they are. I'll tell you. But lemur type. So they small and cute. These are animals. And so again, you have teeth which play a similar role. So they molar. It seems that they are slightly different. They're all very similar, but slightly different. So is there any information we can derive from? So you can actually, this is quite cool. And so in this procedure with analysis, this algorithm that uses you see what those animals eat. The tooth will come to what the animal eats. Which sense when you think about it? These words. This the animal eats leaves. This means that it eats fruits. This means that it eats pets. So this is an example of a communication using diffusion maps. Five types of animals here, and this same algorithm that we have defined makes this decomposition a little sharper, and we now see that there are definitely three animals here, and these two animals eat the same thing. I forget which correspond to what diet reference of the creature in question. But, yeah. In the final moments of this talk, let me just show you just a few iterations. In iterations of this talk, I told you that it's possible to extend the algorithm of the direct complex into higher degrees. And I have computations that create a twist differential in higher degrees. The obvious question is, why do you want to do that?
Yes, and topology, of course, you do it. I mean, degree 1 and 0 are for wimps, you know. Real topologists need high degrees. For example, so recently I came across a very interesting work on vectoring crystals, which is described geometrically. So crystals form relatives until where you may have irregular lattice on one side and a regular lattice on another side, and it will connect across the main wall, and there will not be a collapse structure here. There are many defects in crystals, and that's again a very fascinating subject to study. This is a cool one. You have this regular, only it's messed up when you join up. With a beautiful regular lattice, it's some joker, like this, connect them along an edge of atoms. So you have a regular arrangement, but then a column of atoms goes missing. And the remainder molecules join up as well as they can, but the defect where, you know, the atoms are disturbed. So again, holonomy type methods that detect these defects. So in polynomial look, which is say three molecules to the north, three to the right, three down and three left, you will end up where you started from. But if you try this around a defect, then you will find various problems with the look. For example, it will not close up like here. There is a special name for the vector that you discovered this, which is known in crystallography, but from what it was. Was it represented?
Yeah.
I'll look it up.
So this kind of thing, the strong crystal is in this case, in the case of two-dimensional crystals, it's encoded in a component map from R2 to R2, where you can imagine that you compare an ideal crystal to the ideal one. This component map, and this is the cool point, this is really what makes this whole structure somehow more worthwhile. You have to remember that these comparison maps are local. You take a patch here and compare it to a patch there. There are no global maps, really, because of the defect. And turn into up to local symmetries. You and you know, the course in geometry that you take about crystallographic groups. That's exactly, you relearn all of this all over again. You know that there are those point groups which will describe the fits of the crystal. So this group action is immediately a central part here. Of this, the particular crystal is determined by dimensional Durham complex. You see, there is a second degree order information that this is a two dimensional structure. And this is worth developing, and it's this kind of of interest to people who study geometry of crystals and so on. High dimensions can be attained not just by making the base space more complicated, by creating fibre type structures which encode, if you like, material geometry of the objects that you study. And the more as to how we would extend our persistence and macro type methods to this equation, whenever there is a boggled mind, it typically means that there is an interesting problem. So I'll stop here. Thank you.
Speaker, one more time. Thank you.